In the name of Jesus, you are the roots and the offspring of David. Lord, we bless you. We thank you because of what you're about to do in our lives in this season. We give you all the praise, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Can we take our seat this morning? Praise the Lord. I greet the house. I thank God for Pastor Dele. I greet you, sir. I greet Pastor Maureen, the apostles that God has put over this house. You know, it's been a very apostolic year and a very prophetic one. I just want to thank God for everyone. I just want to appreciate Pastor Dele and Pastor Maureen for this opportunity. I want to also appreciate the other pastors in the house, Pastor Debola Kurumi and Pastor Deji Kurumi. Thank you very much. We've been coming, you know, this year, like I said, if you were part of the prayer meeting that we had, you know, nights ago, this year has been for me, you know, one of the most prophetic, you know, years that I've ever encountered in God. And I believe that it's important that we pay attention, because I don't think it's ordinary that at a very early stage of this year, I think even was before December or something, that you know, Pastor Lee said that we'll be looking at this guy called David, you know, and we'll be exploring every aspect of him. And for me, you know, no, you wouldn't first understand, we had David in Sunday school, yes, we knew. I mean, at some point, you realize that probably all the data you have about David was that he killed Goliath. You know, that there was this young guy who, you know, that Goliath story is so profound. But there is actually a lot more to, you know, to David than just the fact that he killed Goliath. And at least by now, we can all, you know, testify to the fact that, look, David is just, is much more bigger than someone who slayed Goliath. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So, you know, it is a thread, you know, in the midst of all this that I believe that God is trying to pay our attention to. And I pray that, you know, God will help me this morning to connect to a particular stream that I hope that will flow and will help one or two people here, you know, attain to the level of grace and operation that God will have them, you know, touch this day. Hallelujah. You know, like I said, you know, there's a dimension in being pastorally sometimes, but for me, from day to day, I do a lot of software engineering, so it's a very, very intensive, you know, thinking work. So when you are asked to come like this, a lot of times you have to put down, you know, what some of your text so that you can stay in the flow, you know, as God has helped you. Hallelujah. So we're going to take our text this morning. Let's quickly open to Revelation 22:16. You see, because within the operation of David, within the for those of us who are joining us for the first time or you've not been frequent here, we've been exploring this guy called David. And if you have not been studying your Bible, I think it's important that you go and look again, because God introducing David in this dispensation, I don't think is ordinary. And it's to confirm that God is actually talking to us about David. You know, when Pastor Bakare came, he also, you know, ascertained that fact and, you know, dwelled on that very subject, you know. And I believe that message is beginning to catch on, you know, generally now in the Nigerian church. But I'm so happy because we're here, because we are foreigners, and I'm happy that we're part of that, you know, that system that started to, you know, bring this revolution to the Nigerian church. And it's going to sweep like wildfire, you know. Let's take a look at it. And you see, this is exactly, you know, where God is taking his house, because eventually they will start to connect the dots and like, look, where is the source of this stream actually? And they will trace their way, you know, down here. That's what's going to happen. And this is prophecy anyway. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I believe God is doing something awesome, and I just want us to pay attention. Let us not be distracted. You know, the Bible was saying in Revelation 22, verse 16. Can we open quickly to Revelation 22:16? You know, very briefly, Jesus by himself, after all said and done, are we home today? Multimedia. Praise the Lord. Can somebody read 22:16, 22 of Revelations for me? Amen. Hallelujah. And the morning star. Amen. Hallelujah. Look at that word. He said, I am the root and the offspring of David. This is the only time, and one of the few times, that Jesus is giving a personal, this is the resurrected Jesus, you know, giving a very personal encounter, declaration of himself. And this is all he has to say about himself. That look, take note. I am the root and the offspring of David. You start to wonder that there is a flow between Jesus and David that is so strong. And that I think Christ wants us to really pay attention to understanding that you can hardly connect with God, what God is doing in the end time, in the last days, without deliberately connecting with the Davidic flow. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, if you look at the word root, because we'll take a little bit about the word root, and then we'll look at the concept of offspring, and then we'll try hopefully to bring home the message, to Zion. But what is important here is that Jesus also mentioned in Revelation 3, or it was mentioned in Revelation 3, no, there's Revelation 5:5, when the Bible was saying that the prophet was looking at the seals that were sealed, and there was like, oh, nobody was found worthy to open that book. And the Bible said, do be comforted, because the roots of David has opened the seals. That factor was introduced again. And very important. Hallelujah. So you begin to see here that what exactly, is going on. Now, you see, we have no, like what one of the analogies we're drawing during the prayer meeting, we really don't know much about David as a baby. Hallelujah. But we're giving info about Jesus as a baby. We understood that he was a child born by the Holy Spirit. And it was mentioned there that he was going to sit upon the throne of his father David. Hallelujah. But that was the fact that, but as for David himself, we never encountered anything about David as a baby. David just came out of, in quote, nowhere. But here we are, Christ was born a king. And that was exactly what they told them, that Christ was actually born to be the king. Christ, as it were, is actually the king that Israel has been waiting for. In fact, when Christ was born, nobody expected that he was going to come the way he came. They were looking out for someone who was coming to take over the whole world, establish Israel, and be at the supreme helms of affairs. That was exactly what they were looking for. Praise the Lord. But you see, somehow David connected with this current of kingship that was actually originally meant for Christ. Now, you see, the most important thing is that you realize that God was so disappointed when the children of Israel asked for a king. You'll be wondering, why was God so disappointed? Because God was telling them that I am your king. It's not something that he didn't expect them at that time to demand for a king. But somehow, they demanded for a king. And they forced God's hand to create a new flow, which was not a flow that was particularly meant to have occurred at that time, because Christ Jesus was actually the true king. But because David came into the equation, you will start seeing that somehow there's an overlapping of the king of Christ and David within their timeline. And that's where you saw that, yes, we knew about, they documented for us that Christ was born, about the boy Jesus, about the baby Jesus and the boy Jesus. In fact, so well, they talked to us about when Jesus was 12 years old. And then he was so ripe in the spirit that he could deal with the teachers of the synagogue in those days. Do you know what it takes for a 12? Just imagine Toluwani's kind of age now, chatting faith with PD and saying, no, this is not. It was a kind of, just to show you how mature, how spiritually sound, they have become. But I keep wondering why between the age of 12 and 30, and the age of 30, there was no reference to anything that Jesus did. Hallelujah. Somehow, within that same eternal timeline, David emerged within that same age of 12. Because we understood from scriptures, it was about the age of 12, 13, that God was telling Saul that I have found a man after my own heart. So all the anointing and everything of David, the time David himself, his own story, timeline came into sin, was about this age of 12. Now, we didn't know anything about Jesus within that period, but we knew something about David. Hallelujah. Now, you see, like I said, I have to drop this because before we go into so many other things so that we won't miss it here. What I started to see there is that operation of the roots of David taking place, because it was difficult to understand how can you be the root and the offspring of somebody at the same time. Then we started to understand that before David, Christ was. Amen? And he was that root. Now, there was now David, because that's why they gave us the boy Jesus encounter, and then we didn't know anything again, but we now saw David. Now, because the encounter of David as a boy was so unique, between that age of 12, he maximized the full potential of somebody coming into kingship. Jesus did not need to tell us about his own life again. The Bible says that Jesus, about the age of 30, in Luke chapter 3 or 5, he started his ministry. The Bible says that about the age of 30, it was in 2 Samuel, and David was 30 when he started reigning. Why that collision of eternal timelines? Hallelujah. You see, what I'm here to tell you is that somewhere along the line, because just a few days from now, because, you know, like I said, God has a way of bringing this understanding at a very critical moment so that we understand our place, you know, in the scheme of things. Hallelujah. Now, you know, it's like a vision of a very giant tree, a very massive tree, for which, like, Christ himself is the root. And the tree, this tree, is the same tree that today, you know, connects all of us. So that if we can understand our place within that tree, then we will understand that, look, we are connected to something far bigger, amen, than what we think we have. Hallelujah. Now, let's quickly look again to Revelation 3. We'll start to draw some of it, because I'm going to show you a lot of things that how we ourselves connect, you know, to this root, to this tree, and how it applies to, you know, to what God is doing in our lives today. Praise the Lord. Now, the Bible was saying in Revelation 3, when Jesus appeared to the Philadelphia church, this is actually something that I believe that is also a word for us. Now, the Bible says that if you open to Revelation 3, Revelation 3, 10. I just want to quickly pick on. He said, because you have kept my command. Because you have kept my command to persevere, I will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Now, God was showing me that this scripture is very relevant to us today. You see, ladies and gentlemen, there's an hour of trial coming upon the whole world. But the Bible says that you have to keep my command, what? To persevere. This is one thing that this generation is really, really battling with. And is exactly what I believe that God is trying to tell us in this season, in the Davidic story, perseverance. Because when you look at the life of David, when you look at what occurred in this guy, David, between the age of that 12, because like Pastor has been showing us, how can God tell you? I mean, it makes sense. If Paul was going to die tomorrow, King Saul was going to die tomorrow, for God to come and say, okay, at least like 6 months before, how many months before we do election? I think we do election like a year before they change the next president. Okay, at least, worst case, a year before, let God start orchestrating, okay, you know. But how will it make sense to anyone that God is trying to make you king, and then he's telling you like 16 years before, and he's telling you as if he made it so serious. In fact, there was like kind of a ceremony, sacrifice, everything was set. But for another 16 years, David did not become king. Can you explain that? Hallelujah. So we saw, and all through that period, we saw in David a story of perseverance. Because if you look at the life of David, believe me, read the Psalms very well, because a lot of Psalms were written, you know, from the encounter David had growing up. You cannot tell me that there is anything you're going through today that you cannot find in Psalms. Is there anyone there that your case is so special, your difficulty is so special that Psalms doesn't have a message for you? It is not possible. Hallelujah. And then we started to explore the beauty of the interwoven timeline between Christ and David. Because you could see that Christ, the Bible now saying that there is nothing that we're going through that Christ Jesus has not gone through. I think you've read that before. And you'll be wondering that, how did that happen? How could it be that Jesus within 3 years, the only thing we know about him happened in 3 years? And there's no other thing. I mean, there is no other real documentation of how did Jesus go through? What did he go through? Jesus will tell you there is no need for me to go through any of those because there was David. Amen? Because of that, what? Interaction with the Davidic timeline. Because if you look at, he's literally saying that you could look at David, the timeline, and the encounter, the difficulties that David had, all the problems. I mean, what problems can be bigger than the president saying that you must be killed? And he has sent SS and everything that, look, shoot on sight. If you hear that kind of thing, you would not be here. You cannot be yourself. Money will not make sense to you at that point. Have you ever seen money that you have money, but you are in turmoil? You know that kind of thing. I mean, it's not the kind of situation anybody wants to find themselves in. That there is a debt, there's a bounty over your head. This one is not dead or alive. This is dead. Shoot on sight. And running from cave to cave, no money. Even if the money was there, at least you could pay your own guys to go and fight back. But you are with people who probably didn't even have weapons. You understand? To fight back. Hallelujah. So you could see a man throughout the period of his waiting to become king in consistent turmoil, trial, and living in the wilderness. What is so special about this kingship anyway? Hallelujah. So you see, because in our story as believers, if we do not understand our heritage, if we do not understand that, look, being a Christian is beyond occurring. It's beyond just occupying a timeline of existence. That is you actually understanding that, look, God means a business about giving kingdoms to each and every one of us. Hallelujah. You know, if you can't receive it, sometimes it's very difficult to think that, what about me and what about all this? But what I'm just telling you today is that you need to focus on the fact that there is a kingdom. And there is a kingdom that you have been anointed, you know, to take over. Hallelujah. But I'm going to do more teaching this morning. Let's go to Psalms 30 very quickly. Now, we're going to talk about this tree. Now, the first thing I want to show you is that there is a giant tree in the place of the Spirit. That tree, Christ is the root. And in that tree, we are connected to that tree. Amen? We are connected to that tree. So we have to understand Christ as the place of that root, so that we'll be able to understand how we are, you know, all linked to the old Davidic, you know, heritage. Hallelujah. The Bible was saying in Psalms 30, if you can open Psalms 30 very quickly, let me praise the Lord. Are we there? Psalms 30. Okay. I would extol, no. Psalms 80, sorry, not 30. 80. Can read through very quickly. The Bible says, give here, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who dwell, move very fast, you who dwell between the cherub, shine forth. Move quickly. Before Ephraim, Benjamin, Messiah, stir up your strength and come and save us. Move on quickly. Restore us, O God, cause your face to shine and we shall be saved. Move on. O Lord of God of hosts, how long will you be angry against the prayer of your people? Move on. You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in great measure. Move on. You have made us a strife to our neighbor, and our enemies laugh among themselves. Move on. Restore us, O God of hosts. Cause your face to shine upon us, and we shall be saved. Move on quickly. You have brought a vine out of Egypt. You have cast us out of the nations. You have cast out the nations, and you have planted that vine. Now, this is talking about Israel. The Bible says you brought a vine out of Egypt. Amen. And then he cleared out all the nations. This is talking about his people now. The promise he gave, this is the point in which he was actually, you know, doing this plantation. He said, you prepared a room for it and caused it to take what? Deep root. And it filled the land. Amen? So, this was talking about God's execution of his promise to Abraham here. Because to Abraham was given a seed. But every seed must be planted. Hallelujah. But the root of every seed is what is important out of everything that happened. Because when you can have a seed with you, but if that seed is planted and it doesn't take deep root, it might not come to full, you know, execution. Hallelujah. He said, you caused it to take deep root and it filled the land. Move on, verse 9. The Bible says that the hills were covered with its shadows and the mighty cedars with its boughs. So you could imagine a tree so massive that it's casting shadows on mountains. Hallelujah. She sent out her boughs to the sea and her branches to the river. Now, the thing is that God, at this point, has set up a massive tree system, you know, which was definitely, as Christ talked about, that the kingdom is like a seed planted, and then it created a big tree that all the birds of the air, you know, will actually come and draw, you know, strength and, you know, food from it. But the Bible says that, you know, from this point, something happened. Because if you follow the story of the Israelite, their journey, you will realize that within the timeline of the growth of this tree, there was a kind of a shortcut. I mean, there was a cutting off that took place. You know, if you are not born in Israel, that is, if you are not an Israelite by blood, you need to understand how you are connected to the heritage. You understand? That produced David and also eventually produced Christ. Hallelujah. Now, you have to imagine a tree system, and a tree system that is so rooted, you know, that cannot be removed. But you now imagine that that tree is the tree that was planted in Abraham. That is the tree that produced the generations that we see, you know, Abraham, Isaac, you know, and Jacob, and was actually meant to grow all the way, you know, leading to Christ and creating all sort of branches, you know, through which, you know, there is nourishment. But what we see here after this verse, look at verse 12. The Bible says that, look at verse 12. Why have you broken down our hedges so that all who pass by pluck our fruits? Move on. The Bible says, the boar out of the woods uproot it, and the wild beasts of the field devour it. Move on. Return, we beseech you, O God. Look down from heaven and see, and visit this vine. So, in the midst of this whole thing, this tree was cut. And this is Psalms telling us about that there is something that happened here that we need to pay attention to. But now, note this. When you look at what we said about Jesus, David, the fact that we could see an interwoven, you understand, in the timeline of Christ Jesus and David the King, we know that by default, Christ was supposed to appear and just become king. That is, dominate the whole system. But something happened in between. Why we did not see Jesus actually? Because the Bible says he was coming to sit upon the throne of his father David. Salvation has come to Israel. The kind of salvation they were rejoicing for is not the salvation we are rejoicing for today. Amen. They were rejoicing in the fact that, well, at last, somebody that would defeat, what's his name, Nero, and, you know, all the world powers at that time. That's the only thing. They were only looking at the offspring aspect of David, that this is the seed of David, is the son of David, is just coming to sit upon the throne, let him reign, give us everything. That was actually the plan. But the Gentile story happened. It was a kind of, the Gentile story is a different part of the story. Let's move on to look at Isaiah 11, so that you understand. You will see Isaiah here prophesying that title, the root and the offspring of David. You will look in Isaiah very quickly. Let's move to Isaiah chapter 11. The Bible says that in Isaiah, it said, there shall come forth a rod from where? The stem of Jesse. When you hear Jesse now, Jesse is David Jesse. But, you know, it's just to show the accuracy of Isaiah that, okay, it was actually tracking down to David, because Jesse is the father, you know, of David. So this is David Jesse, probably just picked his son name, you know, in the spirit. And a branch, what, shall grow out of his roots. Move on quickly. He said, the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. So these are like, his delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his ears, nor of the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. Move on. But the Bible says that But with righteousness, he shall judge the poor, and he will decide with equity. Now, this is describing kingship. This is describing somebody who is coming actually to execute kingship. Hallelujah. This is a wise king, you know, a king who will bring equity to the system. Look at what the Bible says. And with the breath of his lips, he shall slay the wicked. I mean, this is someone that was coming to defeat, you know, the wickedness system. Move on. Verse 5 says that righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of what? His waist. Move on quickly. The Bible says that the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb. I mean, just imagine that kind of peace where you have wolves, the sharks, and the... Maybe that day we won't have sharks anymore that are giving investments to businesses, or the sharks and the sharkies. You know, we'll be friends. Amen. But you know, the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the young lion and the fatlings together, and a little child shall lead them. Hallelujah. Now, if you move on quickly, the Bible said the cow and the bear shall graze, and the young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like a ox. Move on very quickly. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hole, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in my holy mountain, for the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. So this is the destiny of the kingship of Christ on the face of the earth. That is for the knowledge of God to fill up everywhere. This is actually what we all want to see. I mean, sometimes you're like, okay, I mean, the system is so bad. You know, Christ come and take over everything. You know, that feeling always happens. But this is exactly what is being described here, that Christ the King coming to take over, you know, from the order of the day. But look at what happened next. The Bible now explained that in that day, there shall be what? A root of Jesse. Again, you know, initially he talked about a stem, a branch, but now he's not talking about there shall be a root of Jesse who shall stand as a banner to the people. Now, the children of Israel paid attention to the first part, but they did not pay attention to this second part. Because if you look at this second part, this was the where our whole story appeared. The Bible says that what? Who shall stand as a banner to what? The people. For what? The Bible says, for the Gentiles shall seek him, and they will discover that his resting place is glorious. So they will pitch their tents there. Me and you are Gentiles today, because we are not necessarily born of the nativity of Abraham. You know? But the Bible was talking about that in that root system, the Gentiles will have to plug in. Now, this Jesus came as the root. That is, when Jesus appeared, this root operation was actually what was in force. And that is why the story of me and you, you know, is here today. If he just came as the offering of David alone, without being the root of David, our story will not be in the system. Hallelujah. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. So, if it's important we understand that Christ is also our root. Praise the Lord. Now, if you look at Romans 11, let's quickly go to Romans 11. Because Paul now started to explain the whole thing, you know, fitting the whole picture together. That's how I am. If you look at Romans 11 quickly, the Bible says, I say then, has God cast away his people? He says, certainly not. For I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. Move on. God has not cast away his people whom he foreknew. Or do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah? How he pleads with God against Israel, saying, God, move on quickly. Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altar, and I'm alone, I'm left, and they seek my life. And God told him, look, you are wrong. As far as Israel is concerned, it's not like I'm dumping them. In fact, I have 7,000 people that are yet to bow down to Baal. Hallelujah. Move on. The Bible now says that, even so then, at this present time, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. This is talking about Israel, but move on. And if by grace, then it is no longer of works. Otherwise, grace is no longer grace, but it is the work. If it is of works, it is no longer grace. Otherwise, work is no longer work. What then? Israel has not obtained what it seeks, but the elect have obtained it, and the rest were blinded. Move on very quickly. Just as it's written, God has given them a spirit of stupor, eyes that they should not see. This is exactly the eyes they did not use to see, that there is a root of David. You know, Jesus asked them, he said, whose son did they say I am? They said, you are son of David. He said, is that all you guys can see? That how can he only be his son And then he still called him Lord. How come David called him Lord? So how is it possible that he is his Lord and he is his son? They were confused because their eyes, you know, were covered. Hallelujah. So in the Bible, move on quickly. Move to verse 9. The Bible says that, and David also says, let their table become a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a recompense to them. And let their eyes be darkened so that they do not see and bow their back always. That's why maybe Pharisees are always walking like this, because that was their irritation. Hallelujah. But you could see David here also saying that, look, these guys are going to miss, you know, the picture. There's going to be an interjection somewhere. So Paul started to explain to us that, I said then, have they stumbled that they should fall? He said, certainly not. But through their fall, to provoke them to jealousy, salvation has come what? To the Gentiles. Move on. Now, if their fall is riches to the world, look at that. If their fall is riches to the world, and their failure riches to what? The Gentiles. How much more their fullness? Hallelujah. The Bible says, for I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry. Move on. The Bible now says that if by any means I may provoke to jealousy those who are my flesh and save some of them. Let's move on. The Bible now says in verse 15, for if their being cast away is the reconciling of the world, what will their acceptance be but life, you know, from the dead? Move on. The Bible says, if the first fruit is holy and the lump is also holy, and if the root is what? Holy, so are what? The branches. Hallelujah. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you, being a wild olive tree, the Bible now referred that there is another tree, a wild olive tree, and with them were grafted. This is the word I want us to take note. He said that we were grafted in among them, and with them became what? A partaker of the roots and the fatness of the holy tree. Now, this is exciting, because you need to be able to understand that the same root that produced David, we are connected to that root. So, you see, a lot of names we know of Christ Jesus that we used to, you know, praise the Lord, but we have never addressed them as the root of David or as the root of David, that you are my root. Because we need to understand that place of the root so that we know that, look, this is the same platform that will never be shaken. Hallelujah. So I want you to confess this morning, Christ is my root. Christ is my root. So it's not absurd. We heard of the root of David, and you can actually say the root of Deji, the root of Femi, the root of Tunde. You understand what I'm saying? Christ is the root of Tunde. Christ is the root of Femi. You understand? So you could take that place of confession that Christ is my root. And if Christ is the root, can anything uproot you? Amen. So what do we see here? The Bible says we've become what? Partakers, what? Of the root and the fatness of the holy tree. And the fatness of the holy tree. So I told you about the picture of a giant tree, that tree system. And if some of the branches were broken off, and you being a wild olive tree were grafted among them. Okay, now let's move on quickly to verse 18. Let's move on. Do not boast against the branches, but if you do boast, remember that you do not support the root, but the root supports you. Now, when you look at the process of grafting, how many of us did biology? We all did biology. Yeah. You know, you know how grafting works. Grafting works as simple as actually taking out a branch from somewhere, you know, and plugging it, you know, into another tree. I mean, we know it's just basic. It's basic biology. And somehow they tie it and, you know, do all they need to do. There's all sort of, you know, biological jargons, you know, in the whole process. But what is important at the end of the day is that branch that is coming from, maybe I will call one of the SS3 students here to come and teach us another. But, you know, at the end of the day, that branch becomes fully formed, fully part, you know, of the tree. But I think Paul was trying to tell the Gentiles here that, look, celebrate what you have. Because God had to, imagine, abandon his own original branch so that he can graft us inside. So if you believe the salvation story, you must always rejoice. You must always have reason to bless the name of the Lord. Because if you understand the historical surgical operation that took place in the background so that we could just have an heritage to claim to, it's not an ordinary thing. Hallelujah.
And Paul at that point was saying that this one is too glorious. It's just glorious. Because it's difficult for the human mind to comprehend it. Praise the Lord. But it is something that it's important for us to take, you know, and celebrate. But let's now look at the next draw today. So we've established that Christ is our root, right? But there is now, after the process of grafting, there's another thing now called being rooted. Because you can be grafted, but you yourself may not take root. Hallelujah. Now, if you go, look at the book, the word root, I think there's the Greek, I guess, is like riza. That's the same word, the root of David, is the same word they used when the Bible says that the believer, when they heard the word, they didn't have root. Let's go to Mark chapter 4 very quickly. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Hallelujah. This is kind of like a teaching class, so let's just pay attention. Now, the Bible says that, are we in Mark? Okay. Mark 4, go to 6. Bible says, it was talking about the parable of the sower. Let's go to like 4. Let's just read it from the top a bit. Move to like verse 4. Say, listen, behold, the sower went to sow. Move on. And it happened as he sowed, some seed fell by the what? The wayside. And the birds of the air came and devoured it. Move on. The Bible now says that some fell on stony ground where it did not have much earth. And that scripture says that it lacked moisture. And immediately it sprang up because what? The Bible says it had no depth of earth. Move on to 6. It now emphasizes that but when the sun was up, what? It was scorched because it had no root, and it withered away. Hallelujah. So he's talking here now about the fact that there is now a system in which, yes, you're fully engrafted, but there is now, because there is a process of engrafting, there's now a process whereby you are meant to take root inside that, you know, that vine. Then there's a process in which you are meant to bear fruits. Hallelujah. Because the entire essence is that being grafted is not the end of it. Amen. Being grafted is not the end of it. It is meant to actually produce, you know, a spring. Something is meant to spring out of it. Hallelujah. So what we see, if you move down to verse 16, I guess, move to verse 16. I think Jesus now explained something there. Verse 16. Okay. Now look at verse 16. He said, these likewise, because he's now trying to explain the issue of those who don't have roots. He said, these likewise are the ones sown on what? On stony ground. Who, when they hear the word, the Bible says they immediately receive it with gladness. Amen. But look at what the Bible now says. He said in verse 17 that, move on to 17 quickly. The Bible says, and they have no what? Roots in themselves. So they endure only for a time. Now, in the process of grafting, the Bible is talking about that you yourself, you need to have a root in yourself that you actually need to be rooted in the giant tree itself. So that means that there is a grafting system whereby, okay, you actually have a root in yourself. And in the process, afterwards, the Bible says when tribulation arises, for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. Now, definitely, this is the part where it gets very important, meaning that every word you hear that is like a seed of promise or any word that is given to you specifically will naturally attract tribulation. I don't know if you're hearing me. That is, maybe God has told you that, oh, you are the next significant, you know, great inventor, or you are the next, you are going to have a job, or the CEO of, you know, gave you one very fantastic promise. You've received that word. Now, the mistake most of the time, or when you hear any word, that's because the word itself, the Bible says the seed is what? The word of God. And that seed is only Christ himself that ministers it. Hallelujah. But when he ministered that seed to you, the Bible says that a lot of people immediately receive it with gladness. They receive it with gladness, but they have not taken root in themselves. They don't have root in themselves. So eventually they stumble. So we're going to be able to see that what are we learning? What is the Bible trying to tell us here? What we're saying here is that when we receive the word, the attitude to the receiving of the word should first of it be that, look, rooting must take place. Amen? Now, there is every possibility that people don't understand from what the Bible says here, that every word of God that you received or that you have, if you believe any word of God today, the Bible says that for the sake of the word, persecution is going to what? Arise. So let's analyze the flow a bit. Now, you receive a word. Now, we've talked about, now we know that, yes, Christ is our root. But the next thing we're looking at here is that, how do we take advantage of Christ being the root? Because if you are not rooted in the tree, that is the part of you they grafted out, as his own root. Now, eventually, when you are grafted in, you are meant to develop root in yourself, so that same root can allow you to take nutrients, from the overall tree. Christ is the root, and there's a vine, there's a giant tree. Now, what we now have is that because of the word's sake, the Bible says that immediately there's persecution and tribulation, and a lot of people fall because of the tribulation and the persecution that come as a result of the word. Now, this is what I believe, and this is what I just want us to pay attention to. The rooting process itself, that is, because Jesus is telling us here that not bearing fruit is a problem in the kingdom, beyond the fact that Christ is your root. But not bearing fruit, that is not being rooted in, is a challenge. That rooting process is exactly the most important component as far as this whole message is concerned. Meaning that the Bible says that tribulation and persecution will arise because of the word. May I point to you that, look, the destiny of every rooting process is that of tribulation and trials. Hallelujah. Now, what I'm saying here is that you will naturally, because of the process of rooting in, be put in a process of trial. Hallelujah. Now, over the time of going through that trial, you are developing your roots into the tree. Praise the Lord. So in the process of overcoming and moving through that trial, you will realize that you begin to get engrafted, into the system. Now, what we're saying here is that knowing that Christ is your root is not the final thing, but also understanding that there is actually a rooting process which we must pay attention to at every point in time. Hallelujah. Let's move on to, amen. Can we move on quickly to now? Let's talk about a bit about Revelation 3. Now, if God tells you that you will be king, that is a word. God says you are going to be king. Why will God tell you that you are going to be king, and then you find yourself in the wilderness for 16 years? Does that not bother you? Praise the Lord. Should it not be something that, we often think about that, okay, Lord God, why are you giving me this promise when I don't even see, I can't even see anything that looks like it? The whole system around me is acting contrary to everything I have believed. Praise the Lord. You see, when the Bible says in Mark that people receive the word with gladness, and then, immediately they take it with gladness. You see, part of the challenge is that God can tell you that, oh, you're going to get married. What God is saying is that people just run with that, I'm going to get married. And then you start looking for, try looking out for opportunities to get married. You understand what I'm saying? The next thing you want to do is that you actually want to, you want to see that you're going to get married take effect. Is that not what happens to most of us? Has God given you any promise before? Something that, you receive the word and that this is the... And then the next day, the following day, you actually want to see that, yes, this thing is going to work out. God just told you that, yes, I'm giving you $1 million. And then your next deal, you just put there $1 million. You'll be shocked. For 13 years, you're still looking for that $1 million. I said, God, I thought you told me that I'm getting $1 million. Hallelujah. Now, you see, if you do not understand the rooting process, you will fall away. Hallelujah. Now, what Jesus is trying to tell us is that the moment a word is received, first acknowledge that the root is Christ. If you do not acknowledge that the root is Christ, you will try to want to work it out. Amen. You will want to work it out. But have you realized that a tree is what you see in the surface? The root is the main thing. And if that root doesn't send nutrients up, the branch is just wasting its time. So do not disconnect ever. Do not disconnect your story from the root. That is a message to you. And it's if there's one thing because you see, this thing, as easy as it sounds, we find ourselves day to day, struggling, just trying to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Praise the Lord. But don't ever be in that place. Ponder everything you've been expecting, looking at God for, waiting for. Just backtrack a little bit and acknowledge that there's a root. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, and that's what Jesus was saying, that immediately they just take with excitement. Without excitement, they just want to go and see it come to pass. The Bible says, because they now lack root, everything withers and there is no fruit. Will you bear fruit? Because what is important here is that if we understand this rooting process, what I am getting to believe is this, and I'm agreeing, I'm internalized, that you can become anything that you want to be. That is, David was so majestic at the end of his life. Bible says he was full of majesty. The guy died at a full age, free of distress. The whole Israel was happy. He was a mighty human being. I don't think people go back and read that story and look at, fine, he went through a whole lot of travail. But what was important in the story of David was that the Bible told us that he at his end of his life, he was full of majesty. The Bible reaches wealth. He said God redeemed him from every distress. Who can raise that story? Which person do you know that can come and testify? It's not something you gain by effort. Hallelujah. So what will your story be? And for me, I think it's a choice to accept that, look, if Christ is the root, it must definitely be my offspring. Hallelujah. It must definitely be my offspring. So do not disconnect your story. Because if you find yourself getting to a point where you feel that this thing is not working, and you are filled with ideas on how you think it should work, you are being degrafted. Let's go to Revelation 3. You will see something there. And for me, I have I've gotten to learn certain things, and I've come to say that, tell you this morning that there is nothing you cannot set your eyes on. There is no promise of God that will not be fulfilled. Not one. There is nothing, and this is the way it works. If you have hope and dream for yourself, anyone can dream. Bible is saying that, listen to this. What do you believe you will become? What do you believe? You believe you will become anything. Maybe president of Nigeria, maybe the most sought after doctor in the system, maybe the greatest inventor that ever lived, maybe a billionaire, maybe something far bigger than you could think. Huh? This is what we're learning here. Engraft that dream into the tree. Now, when you are engrafted, that dream was also engrafted with you. Hallelujah. But you cannot seek to bring fulfillment to that dream the way you used to behave when you were in that wild tree. Hallelujah. By the time you are engrafted to this new tree, you have to go it their way. But we don't often understand this. Hallelujah. That the tree, the organics of the wild tree that we used to belong to is different from the organic the structure of the new tree that we've been grafted into. That it is not going to work the same way it worked in that wild tree in this new tree system. Hallelujah. So when you are wondering what's God's word to me, what's his promise to me? His promise to you is that expectation, that dream in your heart. That is his word to you. His promise to you is that thing you see, you become every time you are in his presence, every time you study the scripture, every time you pray. That thing that is always appearing before you when you pray, that is his word to you. That is what is engrafted. That is what must be Davidic. Hallelujah. Or when you pray, you don't see anything. I know it, you know, some people maybe all you just see is that God should just pay my rent and just, you know, should just deal with my immediate problem. That's all you see. But it's not the right thing. You've not been fully engrafted if that's all you're saying. Because if you are fully in, you'll be seeing something bigger than you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now look at Revelation 3. The Bible says that and to the angel of the church in Revelation, he said, write, these things say he who is holy, he who is true, he who has the key of David, he who opens and no one can shut, and he who shuts, and the Bible says no one's what? Opens. So he introduced that Davidic frequency here again to say that, look, I hold the key of David. But what is important? Why am I opening up this hub? Move on. The Bible says here that I know your works. See, I have set before you an open door. And this is a word to TBC, I believe. I have set before you an open door and no one can shut it. And that's a word to you as well. He said, for you have little strength and I've kept my word. Now, look at that. Even with your little capacity, with your little strength, the Bible says you have kept my word. The question here is this. With the little that you have, what are you doing? Hallelujah. You know, we want to all accomplish something big. But I think over the period of David, Basilia has told us over the time that the time that you are so little in your eyes, the time that you don't, you know, that it's just a player between you and God, what is it you are doing with those moments? That is exactly what counts. You know, this has to sink in us very well. That with my little strength, you know, with my little capital, with my little money, with my little members, what have I kept to? Hallelujah. He said, you've kept my word and have not what? Denied my name. And when you look at the church system, because he's talking to the church here, but it could also refer to any one of us who is integrated into the church system. You will see that he knows that when you are little, when the system is not like it's favoring you, there is every reason to want to deny his name. Deny his name is not until you curse God and, you know, it's just, you all realize that, well, this name of Jesus doesn't seem to be working here. Let me look for some other, you know, ways out of it. Hallelujah. Move on. The Bible says in verse 9, it says that, indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Look at this. When you look at this synagogue of Satan now, it reminds me of the synagogue of the people that they said they act like they are Jews. They look like they are among us, but they are not. I mean, you will see, because they're addressing a church here, and the context here is that you will see a lot of church system rising up. They look like you. They are like, hey, they know the amen thing, but most of them don't have any roots in Christ. Don't we have that story everywhere today? I mean, everywhere they know the hallelujah that you know, but they are not, something is not there. He said, indeed, he said, Bible says, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have what? Loved you. So, what is the Bible saying here? That, you see, when everything is going to add up, within that your little strength, by the time I'm going to elevate you, your resources are all these people that you see today, that are within that synagogue. They are the ones that is preserving for that your system. Hallelujah. Amen. And I believe also that's going to be our story in TBC, because sometimes I keep wondering, oh, how are we going to fill this place? The Bible just, God will just say, that one should not be your headache. Because these people, one day, will flood in here. That, look, oh boy, I'm leaving this synagogue of Satan. Let me go to where, you know, people are keeping the faith. Hallelujah. Look at verse 10. The Bible now says in verse 10, very quickly, it says that, look at verse 10. There's a word for us there. Verse 10. 10. He said, because you have what? Kept my what? Command to... I mean, how can God's command be to you to persevere? How can that be a command? Okay, what's your commandment, oh Lord? Persevere. Is that how you command? Persevere. How do you carry out persevere? Can you tell me how do you carry out persevere? Just persevere. I mean, there is no... It's just to persevere. You know, this is a tag our general doesn't like. We can't cope with this... We want to see it. Hallelujah. He said, but it is my command. Command. And that is all. I will also keep you from the hour of trial. that shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. You see, things, this world, things is not going to get any better for it. That is this world. I'm not talking about you, the world. If you've been following the trend and the news, you realize that no news has improved from the since the beginning of this year till now. As in none. None. And that's why I keep saying that this is one of the most apostolic and prophetic years we could ever encounter, because God bringing David into the scene shows that truly there is an hour of trial that is coming upon the whole world. And it's a message to you that in David, find the courage to persevere. Because how can a man wait 16 years, throughout most of which time he was in turmoil and in wilderness, somebody wanting to kill him with no money, with just broke and busted human beings around him, waiting to become king? How can? What did it take him to wait that long? Hallelujah! He obeyed this command. Persevere. Because with perseverance, you can open any door. You can open any door. As far as it is God's commandment to you to persevere. You see, the hour of trial is upon the world. And that's what we were also talking about during the prayer. That the hour of trial is here. It was the first thing that God enlightened my eyes to see when I, you know, was seeking it very recently. He said, look, things are going to get difficult. Things are going to get difficult. But this is the secret. That you might understand the concept of the root and the offspring of David. And you know that the most important command here is that you have to persevere. Do your time. Because your rooting process is what takes place during that period. Hallelujah. Amen. So what are we saying here? Two things. When you persevere, just as David did, and he got to the end, he gave birth to an offspring. Now, after that is the offspring stage. Because the truth of the matter is that, you see, at the end of everything, like we said, it is all about your offspring. You know, there is a mindset in which, okay, oh, yes, so I'm going to be rich. It's going to be well with me. That's a mindset. But beyond that, there's still an offspring. That is God's own interest. The rich and everything is just, you know, one of those things. That offspring. What's going to be your offspring? Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're rounding up now. Now, if you look at that, now, Jesus now described himself as the offspring of David, which is very important because as the offspring of David, the entire meaning of that was that, look, in David, I am the one that is springing out of David. The Bible even says, use that word spring somewhere. It is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah. You understand? So being the offspring of David is the fact that I am the eventuality of David. I am the final generation of David. I am the complete outcome of the entire thing that is happening in David. It is me. I am the offspring of David. And the most important thing, the message for us is that if Christ is our root, it will definitely become our offspring. Now, look at this. You will see how being the offspring, because the offspring stage is more like also can be also likened to the birthing stage, the birthing process, you know, of Christ. Hallelujah. Because if you remember the birthing process of Christ, what happened was that at the point of the birthing of Christ, there was a world system that altered the entire, you know, frequency of the earth, and Mary and Joseph had to move to Egypt. I mean, had to go to return back to the city of David, because the Bible says that then there was a decree that everybody must be registered. So you have to go to your native, to the place where you really belong. Hallelujah. So there was a shaking system then that produced the fact that they had to go to the city of David, you know, to go and deliver, you know, the baby Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, Pastor has been mentioning something, and it's very important that you see when it now eventually comes to the stage of the offspring, because we know of the rooting process, we know of the perseverance, the stage, you know, then we know of the offspring stage. At that offspring stage, there is also a high level of resistance, amen, in the system. I mean, the enemy cannot afford you to release that offspring. Hallelujah. Because that is another danger to his plans. Have you seen that in Revelations? The story of the of the dragon. Yes. Please, can we quickly get there? That should be Revelation 12, is it? Yes. The Bible says, so the great dragon was cast out, and the serpent of old. Move to verse... No, go to... Let's start from verse 1. I'm coming. Verse 1. But if you look at this story, let me just... I won't... You know, the Bible says a great sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed in the sun and in the on and with the moon under the feet, under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. The Bible says this woman being with what? With child. She cried out in what? In labor and in pain to give birth. We also mentioned during the prayer season that, look, when it's time to give birth, God is going to call for crying out. The Bible says the Gentile will seek him. That is... It's going to be a season in which people must, you must deliberately cry out. Hallelujah. And if you look at also how accurate we have been this year, we've also moved into a season of prayer now. Amen. Because the only thing that must happen in this season is that you've been given an opportunity to come and cry out. Hallelujah. The Bible says that she was about to deliver. But what you see here was that the beast appeared, trying to what? Prevent her from delivering. Because the beast cannot afford another Christ to be born. The enemy cannot afford that's your story, that's your stage, should come to maturity. Because if it ever happens, what is going to happen is that another offspring is out whose destiny again is to step on his head. Hallelujah. Amen. So this is why, as far as you are rooted, you are connected to Christ, sometimes, you know, getting to that offspring stage of actually seeing the eventuality of what God has promised can be so difficult, can be so demanding. But the command to us this morning is that what? Is that we should persevere. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So what are we looking at in summary? There is me. There is my life. The way I want to live it. The way I just want to live it. Then there is God's will. You know, that is, there's the engrafting process in which, okay, look, that my life, the way I want to live with, is intersected, you know, in the story of salvation, and I'm engrafted in Christ. Then there is me eventually prioritizing the will of God according to his word. That's okay, fine. I will do it your way. There is me being tried and tested doing that, now seeing that the system is resisting you doing that. There is me receiving the Holy Spirit and getting huge, consistent encouragement from the Holy Spirit that I should endure and that I should persevere. Hallelujah. There is me enduring and still wondering why it's taking so long. Now, there is me going through that stage, eventually attaining to maturity. Amen. Where I am now about to give birth. Hallelujah. There is now the dragon, that's the political system of the day, readjusting itself to either pressure you to the extreme. That pressure itself is going to have to, of course, definitely make you make some alignments, which will eventually position you into your manger. Hallelujah. There is now Christ in me being born. Hallelujah. And the Bible says from that point, you know, God took the child to heaven. You see, ladies and gentlemen, what is the most important thing for us to take care of this today? Is the fact that if you can understand that our entire existence on the face of the earth is that God, the project of Christ being born, did not just end with Mary giving birth to Jesus. That the project of Christ being born is still taking place today in the story of me and you. We will approach everything with a different mindset. Hallelujah. Is Christ glorious? Is Christ glorious? Then what is inside of us is glorious. Hallelujah. I think at this point, I just want us to bow our heads and stand up and pray.